Good morning. I, Dr. Rekha Sapra, on behalf of Bharati College and IQAC team, welcome Dr. Ramesh Chandra Sharma on this important webinar session on live digital repositories for lectures, courses, and digital library. I welcome you, sir. It's a very, very timely organized webinar, and I'm sure we all are going to benefit from this webinar. Dr. Sharma is at present holding the post of Associate Professor in the School of Global Affairs, Ambedkar University. He has been a visiting professor to many educational and technological institutes all over the world, just to name a few: Malaysia, Brazil, Fiji. And he has been the director of IGNU as India Regional Director. And what we are going to have his presentation is very, very relevant, and it is a very timely one at this moment. I welcome you once again to this webinar. Thank you very much.
That's outset, let me thank Professor Rekha, principal of Bharati College, Nandini ji, and Dr. Priyam for inviting me for this workshop. And before we begin, maybe I can request that I can mute every one of you. I think let me do it, because
yes,
then
please do it.
There
yes.
is no one else is speaking. And if there are any, at present we are 59 in number. So I may suggest that you all kindly open the chat, and in the chat box, maybe you can type your name if all are from Bharati College only, so that they may have a sort of attendance. Because the chat will be saved from there. And in addition to that, whenever you want to ask any question, either you can raise your hand, because there is a facility in the system, or just type into the chat box. And time to time, I will keep looking into the chat messages. And then we can have the question answer session. It's not necessarily that try to see that the questions which you ask are related to this, but even otherwise also, you are welcome to ask questions related to online teaching learning. That's perfectly all right. And I think let me see the chat. Perhaps we are only having, yeah, great. Okay, so, okay, I will begin today. I will be speaking on the various kind of digital resources which are available to us, and they have a very significance for all of us as a teacher, as a learner, and as a researcher also, because in addition to our teaching role, we are supposed to conduct research also. Now, what do? When we normally, if we have to prepare our lesson, if we have to teach our students, then prepare our lesson, we have to write some article, doing something, we search for content for that, means some related material, because it becomes difficult for us to create everything from our own, you know, to write everything. Or maybe if I have means I can think of something speaking on my own also, but if I want some, say, image or related thing to that, definitely I will depend on internet for that. So that poses us a very big challenge. And perhaps I don't think that there is a need of it for me to explain it to you. The famous case of the photocopier versus the publishers going on for the Delhi University for such a long time, and ultimately it ended up into the court of law. And then it was settled there. So the copyright issue becomes a very important thing here. And you may be knowing that the plagiarism also, it is a very serious offense. So the piracy, the infringement of copyright laws, et cetera, they are very serious thing. That doesn't mean, and what happens, the challenge is that for our teaching, learning, and research purposes, we need access to the material. But most of the textbooks or the journals, they are subscription based. or copyright protected materials. Means we need to have them, through the authorized means. Either we purchase them, we subscribe to them, something like that. And this creates a challenge when the funding is an issue. And as we know that the textbooks are expensive, so it becomes difficult for the teachers to purchase those books on individual level also, or for the libraries to get those sets into the library, because even the budget of the libraries is also shrinking. For that matter, there are certain things into it. But we need access to the material. So what happens to that? What has happened that there were some challenges. Let me show it to you that what has happened over a period of time. Okay, I'll come to here and I'll share my screen. Okay, perhaps now you can see there are certain changes. One is the change in philosophy, the social factor. Change in philosophy indicates that when we were facing the difficulty of copyright things in a rigid way, and there is nothing wrong with it. If I'm the author of anything, if I'm the creator of anything, if I'm the author of any content, definitely I would like to protect my holding on that. So, but then parallelly, a change in philosophy for the sharing was happening around us, and that's why the open source tools, the open content, open access things, they started emerging. The philosophy here is the philosophy to share, but that share means with a flexible terms, either by waiving off our license which we hold on that content that way, or releasing it with some sort of a limitation that under these conditions you can use this material. The second was the technical change. The internet was getting powerful. Its access is getting increased to a large extent. So more people, they are connecting online, and then it becomes easier to access the materials, because for offline, for printed base, it becomes not that fast. It has certain restrictions. Suppose if you have one book and there are 50 students in the classroom, very well you can imagine that how it can be distributed. But if you have some PDF, you put it on the internet and immediately everyone can access that. So affordance of internet getting more powerful, getting wide area coverage, and the price is coming down for the package for the internet use. Another important thing was the emergence of alternative copyright licenses. So on the one side, we have this copyright clearance rules, and on the another side, we have certain alternative open licenses. These are the open licenses which are very beneficial to us. So let me see what are the various kind of open licenses which us. In fact, these we call them as the open content. And what does it indicate? It indicates that it should qualify these five things. We should be able to reuse it, we should be able to revise it, remix it, redistribute it, and retain it. That becomes an open content. Say, for example, as in open access. That's why, due to these issues, the concept of open access emerged, and it has become very much powerful. That now we have DOAJ, the Directory of Open Access Journals. If you want to find some material, it's a better resource to go to doaj.org and search the material from there. So that way, and not only in terms of education, even in terms of business also. You may be knowing him, the image on your screen now. Elon Musk, he is the holder of the Tesla company, which makes its electric cars. Why electric cars? Because these are the zero pollution. But recent, very means sometimes ago, I think it is now around 2 years ago, something like that. He released the patents of his car, that if anybody, because I cannot make the electric cars for the whole of the world, and pollution is a serious business for every one of us. So he has released the patent of his electric car, that if anyone wants to make an electric car, they can go ahead with that. So that is, you can see now the significant. Even you may be knowing that in our cars, we have that seat belt, the three-pin seat belt. Do you know that it was the patent of Volvo company? But since it is related to our, it's a life-saving device, they also released those patents for that. So sometimes for the better benefit of the humankind, we release it. We don't patent it. And similarly, the World Wide Web. It was devised by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, and he never patented it. The web is now 30 years old, Sir Tim Berners-Lee. These are the things which the people do. So it means the change in philosophy, it means that there is a, means we want to share the things that, okay, if I'm having something, let me share it with others so that they can make use of that. And that's why parallelly we had open content, like the open course material, the open material by the open universities, as the open content. You may be knowing that United Kingdom Open University was the first open university of the world. So, and it offers its course materials. And then in India, in 1982, the first open university, the Andhra Pradesh Open University, came into being. After that, in 1985, IGNU came, and currently we have around 17, 18 state open university and one national open university total, like that. On that sense, so those things are there. So these are the course means the open resources are those which we use for teaching, learning, and research purpose, and they can include anything. Means I consider them, if you take a single image up to a complete program, on the between that spectrum, anything which we allow others to use with certain flexibilities, which as an author I feel that I can go ahead with that, they are known as the open educational resources. So this is the thing. These are the various journals, and let me show you what are those. Actually, if you may be knowing that one of the result, when Sir Tim Berners-Lee invented the web in 1990s, early 90s, when he was working with CERN, that was the stage of web one. That was the static web, the stage of static web. Means you upload something. That was the dot-com era. Everybody was starting having their own website, and very soon that bubble got burst up. But there were advancements into that. From the static web, you upload your material, people download it, and that's all. But then there came the second stage called as read-write web, where in not only we are reading the web, we are writing on the web also. And how do we write on the web? How do we write on the web? Okay, just type in the chat box. Anyone like to answer? How we can write on the web? Hypertext, Google Doc, yes. The simple thing, you know, everybody does that currently nowadays. Whenever you post anything on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, something, anywhere you like something, you upload something. Yes, Khushi, you are right, Wikipedia. These things we are now writing on the web. And Khushi has given a very good example of Wikipedia. The Wikipedia is the result of this Web 2 stage. Web 2.0, and this term Web 2.0 became so popular that nowadays most of the things we like to indicate through its version. Like now currently we are in lockdown 3.0, so no, first phase, second phase, now in the third phase. We say industry 4.0, we say education 4.0, something like these are the versions of that. And Wikipedia has become a good example of the wisdom of masses. Wisdom of masses. Here, anybody can contribute to it because it is open platform. and all the entries you can see, you can download. In fact, for my purpose, whenever I need certain thing, I prefer to go to Wikipedia or Wikimedia, a foundation from there, because they are the openly licensed materials without any issue of copyright. You just need to cite them properly, either give the URL of that page or the link is given at the end there, then you can copy it. So there are many types of open licenses, but this in the around year 2000, the Creative Commons was established by Larry Lessig in United States. It's a sort of a non-profit organization, and they suggested certain open licenses, which are these six kind of open licenses. So I will explain them briefly, and then we will go to our resources main. The knowledge for you of these licenses is essential, because only then you will be able to identify that what you can use freely. So number one, just think that on one side you have the complete copyright things, for which you know, if you see a book, you on the credit page you will find a very big paragraph that you cannot transmit, copy, distribute this without the explicit permission of the publisher or the author or the owner or copyright holder and this and that, unless it is explicitly. But then on the another side we have the public domain things. So these are the two extremes of the spectrum. Public domain, which are freely, like for example Ramayana, Mahabharata, Munshi Premchand ki kahaniya, and those products for which there is no copy holder now. In between lies these open licenses, which they say, and in these are the in the education domain we call them open licenses. Otherwise, in terms of software, we have a different kind of license, like for example GNU, like Unix, Linux, etc., or BSD, the Berkeley State. They also give the licenses for softwares. So that's a separate domain of work. But they are also the kind of open licenses to help us to create open source softwares, or to distribute them, to share with the community, back with them. So here are we having six kind of open licenses. If you see any article anywhere, any photograph, any blog, any video there, if this sign is there, it means you don't need to seek permission. The biggest advantage of these things here is that in terms of copyright, you need to seek the permission. You need, because you may be authors of some books, say for with the Springer, or there are so many, Routledge is there. There are so many publishers, and when you author a book with them or write a chapter for them, they send you a copyright form, and then they ask you that if you used any third party content into it, please be sure that you have obtained the permission from them. That kind of permission is required for there. So in these cases, wherever you will find these kind of icons, these logos, it means the first step is clear. You don't need to seek permission. The permission is already granted. Just next, depending on the complication now, from the simple one, CC BY, up to CC BY NCND, just we need to see that what we can do with that content. So let me explain. If you see any content on which it is written CC BY, it means you just use it. There is no need for you to write to the author or the publisher to that. Thus, just cite it. Citation is essential in any case across anything. Because if we do not cite anything, it means we are claiming that that content is ours. So citation is necessary. That's the ethical thing. That's the first thing. Then we have to the right of it CC BY SA. This, the all other licenses, they indicate that the if you are using any material which has this license of CC BY SA, it means you can use that material, but then you will be giving the same license to your resultant material. If you are creating it, if you are using open source something and you are creating out of that, you can further give a certain kind of license to that. Here, in case of if I am using CC BY material, I'm using that, say of Dr. Priyam, she has written some article and I used her article with me, and then it was CC BY. After that, I can make it public domain. No problem into it. Because I changed it, I can give it CC BY or change it. But here, in case of CC BY SA, this license will go. Then CC BY NC stands for non-commercial use. So any content which is there, we may not be able to make a commercial use of that. Means we can't sell it, we can't charge the people for it, but we can edit that, we can revise it, we can make a derivative out of that. So you can remix, you can revise, you can remix, you can do those things. The 5 R's which I showed you in the previous slide. ND stands for non-derivative. Non-derivative means you cannot change the content. You have to use it as such. And then comes the NCSA or NCND. They increase in the complexity. So any kind of content which has NCND into it, it means you have to use just purely as such. No commercial use, no derivative allowed for that. You can't remix into other things. You just use it as such. And there are certain articles, there are certain photographs available with the organizations, with the people. There they allow you to use them for that. So that way, these are the licenses. I hope the licenses are clear. They have been used across the world, and these are current. SA stands for share alike. Share, SHARAREALIKE, alike. It means you used it and now you share it, but share it with the same license. That is share alike. In case of others, you can have a different license depending on the situation, but here you will keep them the same. There are many platforms and millions and billions of resources are available with us, and they are being adopted and being followed by almost all the. ND stands for non-derivative. Non-derivative understand makes it that, say for example, this is the cover of the for my page, and I release it with some source. If it is non-derivative, you can't change the design. That way means you cannot edit it. That is derivative. Then it is available in many languages, and there are so many resources in millions of available there. We will see some of the examples now. Let me change my screen, and I will go live now with my okay, stop sharing. Okay, are there any questions so far? Okay, I have replied to assistants and ND stands. Okay, there are no questions. Very well. So, okay, here is my Firefox, and let me go there. Okay, now for our teaching, learning, research, any other educational activity, what are the digital resources which we can use freely so that we do not land in some kind of trouble? We will be searching for images, for audio, for video, for text, and then we will look at certain repositories which are available with us. Okay. So first of all, say for the images, and these are the websites which I use personally for my own work, means, and I have found them very effective. One of the favorite with me is Unsplash. So this is that website, unsplash.com, and you can see that it offers you a wide variety of themes, topics, what you want to search. So let's make a search. For example, nowadays we search, say for example, for Corona. So we'll just put our keyword, and it will show us, it is showing us, we can search it with virus, pandemic, COVID, COVID-19, person, gray, Corona, whatever. And you see what are various kind of images which we think that are okay. And let me see that, okay, I want to use this image. So here you can see, this is the, here it is showing you download for free. And then below here it is share and its information, the and some related images. You can click on download and it will open a box where you can download it to your local disk similar, and it says that just say thanks, means just copy this information and paste it in your PPT or anywhere else, and that will do. So there are two ways to cite these kind of resources. Either you can use the URL on the top of the page, its URL, because that is the direct link to this image, or you can use this one also. And it contains only two things here: the platform name Unsplash and the author name Akshan Afrozani, who is the author of this. So that way you can download, and you can see any kind of image. There are, say, it's a wonderful, very huge resource, and then you can find from here any kind of orientation. If you want some picture, say in landscape mode or portrait or something, you want to search an image with a particular color code, so you can select that, and then if there is anything pertaining to that, it may return if these are available in that database. So it will return it back to you. The another source is Pixabay. And you can see that around 2 million high quality images are available here. And okay, before that we go into it, even information as a general knowledge for you. Basically, on broad sense, we can divide the images into two categories: the raster images and the vector images. And sometimes you must have seen that if you use a photograph and if you try to zoom out, enlarge it, it gets pixelated. Ultimately, some squares, they will start appearing into it. And so that one single square is called as one pixel. And it depends on how many pixels are there in per square inch. The more the number, the better the high resolution of the picture would be, and the better quality of it would be. And that's why, if you think see that nowadays the VDU, the visual display units, in simple terms you call them monitors, say like television screen, they come, their power is getting enhanced, means starting with 4K, now you have HD, UD, and further the high capacities in which they can reflect millions and billions of colors, bringing it the picture as it we see in our real life. Because our human eye, we can process millions of colors, millions of pixels easily. So the camera lens making it so powerful with them. So for your Manjoji wants to ask, and type your question there. We can use for our two purposes, that if we want to use anything for offline purpose or for offline purpose. If you are using for offline purpose, you can select the high resolution picture because it won't affect. Suppose you want to make a banner out of it. If you take the high resolution picture, it will be good. The result will be better for it. But if you are using it for an online purpose, which you want to upload on your website or send it by email, then it is better to use a low resolution image. And the format would be JPG, TIFF, or PNG. Those images are the format of the images is better to be used in those conditions. Okay, Sangeeta is asking, at some places nothing can be copied or downloaded, a simple point is made, how to deal with that? It's a good question. It is a Pixa, P-I-X-A. You can see here in the upper left corner, Rakhi, you can note down the name. It is P-I-X-A-B-A-Y, Pixabay. Sangeeta, the answer to your question is that in case if there is no indication what kind of license that material has, it means it may be copyright protected. there are you have two alternatives: either don't use that because in case of confusion, or simply you may find the author's details somewhere, whether it is publisher or the website or something. You can drop an email to them asking them that can we, if we want to use your material, can we use it, like that. So that is a way out for that situation. So let's see how we use Pixabay. Say, for example, I want to search something for photosynthesis. And here, so many images it is showing me. And let me see which image I would like to use. Okay, say I'm just at random selecting, say, this image. So the image will appear here. Now here, see, on the upper right corner, Carter Nick, author, already contributed 69 images in total, and it is a free download. And this is the interesting here, see, it's license for this image. It says that you can make a free commercial use of it. So you want to take this photograph, make a poster out of it, sell it to the market for 100 rupees, no problem. This author, the owner, don't have any objection into it. And secondly, here, this has gone one step ahead. They say that even if you don't want to give the credit to Nick, it's okay. Or you don't want to give the credit to Pixabay, it's okay. No attribution required. You can simply go ahead and use this image. And if you make a search on this website, you will find almost all the resources which this site offers to you. They are with a similar kind of license. So you are free to use them, and then you can make use of them and like that. So this is the another resource. Then I have another resource which is called as potter.com. Is my screen that's stopped? Okay, it is coming now. Yes, this is fotter.com, F-O-T-E-R, fotter. And you can see here 335 million free stock photographs. It's a very big resource which is available. My mouse is not moving on your screen. Is it coming up? Yeah, okay, it is coming. Maybe it got slowed down. So let's see what this site does. And say, for example, I want to search something on animals, and I want to make a search for lion. And now you can see it is showing me. So I can sort it from here, relevant, recent, interestingness, depending on that, from short. Or it I can choose the license, all kind, or for which I can make a commercial use of them, or for those which I can make a non-commercial use of them. These are the licenses it offers to me. And say, okay, let me select this image which I find that this is good for me. Now, this site has a certain interesting things with it. Number one, it shows you the various kind of dimensions for this image. Not means for every image, this site which it holds. Here it is showing you the size, small, medium, and large. So what do you want? If you want to use this photograph for your presentation, go for the small, because it won't affect. If you want to use it for your banner, poster, something like that, which you will be using your print medium, or for the banner as a website banner, you can go for the large. You can download it. The extra thing which this site offers is you to allow you to embed. So you can directly embed this image. You can simply click on the embed button, and it will open this gear. It is asking you the alignment where you want that photograph to be on the page, and then the size, it is 600 pixels, and you click on get the code. Now, this is the code which is available to you. and you copy it and paste it in your HTML on your website there. So that way you can. Here is, there are licenses. It is CC 0 license, which is a public domain dedication. Now, you have heard about public domain. You have heard, you saw those 6 licenses. So there is one more license. It is called as CC 0, which comes in between your copyright and CC BY. Here, what the person does in public domain, nobody is the copyright holder. And that depends on a country to country, that what material, what content can become, can fall into public domain. Like in India, it is perhaps 75 years of age after the death of the person, if it has not been explicitly transferred to the heirs, that the copyright is not continuing, that then it can, it may become like Mahabharata, Ramayana, etc. So they are in public domain. That's why you see there are so many versions coming up into that. Those things. So here it is CC0. CC0 means I hold the copyright of it, but I'm releasing my rights for any person other. And there are many people who do this, like the photographers, they do that. And Khushi at that time told about Wikimedia. I'm the board member on the Wikimedia Foundation, OER Foundation. And normally what we do, you know, the Wikimedia Foundation, it is one of the biggest encyclopedia. They have a lot of images into it. But from where, have you ever wondered that from where all these images come? What we do, suppose you have an event in your institution, say for example, graduation ceremony or a musical ceremony or any other thing, or there are so many functions, they are held every time. And the people, they call the professional photographers. That these photographers, they don't take, you know, it is not the time of the older time when we used to have our reel in the camera. And we used to, you know, think that, no, let me take only 10 photographs because my reel will be full. Now, these are all digital cameras and we have big memory. So we don't mind clicking. And if you click the photograph, which the professional photographs do in the burst mode, in which 10 images by one click the camera can take. So these photographers, they don't use, if they have taken 1,000 photographs of an event, they won't use all those photographs. They will select the best and rest, they will keep them and they may discard them. So we approach them and we request them that these are the photographs that are not usable to you. Anyway, you are going to discard them, but they may be useful for the community outside. Can you share these photographs with us? And believe you me, many people, they have happily shared those kind of material with us, and we freely then upload them on these sites. Do we give do you know recognition to them? It's not that we just took them and forgot the person. No, that is not done. The site means the acknowledgement is their contribution is duly acknowledged. But that way the community, the material, the resources, the repositories, the digital resources, they keep on increasing. And then it is showing you how to attribute this photograph. So that way it, you know, you can use any image. And one thing here, if you note, says that commercial use of it. So you can make a commercial use of this photograph. And the second thing, it says that modifications allowed. So how do you modify an image? Let me show you an example of that. That how do you modify that image? Okay, I will change my screen again. And here you can see it. This is an example where a person has given this open license to their blog. This is an example where Paul Allen School, they have released their course material on computational neuroscience with an open license. So yeah, all of the program has been given. And these are the resources which I showed to you. Here is the image on which has been used. This photograph has been used. The first is the title of that. Then it, this photograph is by Alex and released under CC BY SA license. So that way it has been used there. And how to do that. I am going there. Okay, this is the here. How you can modify an open a content. This is the original image here, which is the title, that Golden Reading Barron's Dog Training Bible. This is a book, and this photograph was taken by Andrea, and she released this image as CC BY 2, because at that time when she took, that was the version 2 of these licenses. Now what happened next, this image was used by Kristen, and the what Kristen did is to paste another photograph on the top of that, because that was released under CC BY. So if it is CC BY, I can modify that image. So this is how, and then you give the source, first the original source, and you tell that this work now, Golden Reading Open, I changed the title, I gave the new title to my photograph as Golden Reading Open, and I told that now this is a derivative of this thing. So that way we do it. Now how, what is the formula to do it, is that you need to remember this TASL formula. Means if we are using it wherever we have this, please follow this rule, that the title of the source, who is the author, and what is the license. If there is a source, there is a URL, the link, it is great. Otherwise, if you saw it in case of Pixabay or the Unsplash, it was giving you the author name and the platform name, like that. So you means any of these things, that way how you use them in this way. This is an example of what we can do with these kind of materials. Here in the top you see we have the raw materials. Using these raw materials, we create our first product, which is in the center of the screen. And from this image, if you come to the bottom, you see add and subtract. So either we can add something to it, or we can take out something from that, because it allowed us. In case of copyright, we cannot do that. Then we can repurpose, we can reuse, we can reorganize, we can remix, we can add something to original, or we can just shape it depending on what is available with us. So that way these open resources, these open access articles are useful to us. It's not only the image, even with the text which is available to you as open access text, it allows you. You need to see that with what kind of license it has allowed us to go for that. So that way, now I will come back to my website. Okay. Here is that image we were working on that. So this is about this website, and then I'll show you about two more sites, which is Flickr. Flickr.com. This is a very, very big repository of images. You can see it says that it is home to tens of billions of photographs and around 2 million groups. It is providing you resources for that. So, and this is simple to use it. Say, for example, I want to search something on leaf. And there are so many images it will show. On the top, you see here on the left, it shows you any license. You click on that, and from there, you select what you want to do. Any license will show you the copyright protected also. But all Creative Commons, or you want to use something which is specific in nature, like only the commercial use, if you have that objective in mind, or you want to think that you want to use some image, but you want to change something in that image, maybe the color or the pattern, or you want to add some extra image. For example, say if I want to use this banana leaf and I want to put a beetle on it, so that way that will be called known as the modifying that image and commercial use or something like that. Then this website allows us one more interesting thing, that we can go by a specific color code also. Suppose I want to search certain images in which red color will dominate, so it will allow us to search those with the help of that here. So you can go, it depends on your purpose, what you want to use in what way. There you can go with that. So that is Flickr. And now next we come to the quite powerful Google. Simple, the Google search engine. It's a very powerful, and there are certain things, those of you who are from either science or mathematics or computer science, you may be knowing one word called as Boolean. I'm typing it on the screen now. You can see it is showing you Boolean search. So Google allows us for Boolean search. What are those Boolean? And, not, or, something like that. And you know, if I say and means two things. If I say, for example, Delhi and Corona, it means both these things they should present. If I say Delhi or Corona, either of the two. If I say Delhi, not Corona, it means Delhi will be there, Corona will be excluded. These are called as Boolean operators, and we use them while we make certain searches for us. But how do we use Google? For example, if I want to search something on, say, let us just, I'm taking this Photopea. This is a software. Let me search for photosynthesis. And I want to search anything, say for example image or something. It is showing me all these things, and some of them may be copyright protected, some may be free, how to search them. And this is applicable not only for image, it is applicable for everything when you are using Google. Go to, you make your search, after that go to settings and click on advanced search. Now this advanced search is quite powerful here. On the top you give your keyword, the phrase which you want to search, and if you want you can put these Boolean things, exact quotes, with or without something, means and or not, those things they will come here. No, not necessary, but it has the power of that. Then it is offering you any size, what kind of size, large, medium, larger than, even you can find larger than 70 megapixel, which is a very, very huge kind of banner. Any color, any aspect ratio, those things. The last one is important for you. Here you see it is asking you to share commercial use, modifications allowed, what there, and you click on that. And after that it will return you, and here you can see that the top results, they are from Wikipedia, because Wikipedia allows you to share them freely, and that way you can scroll down, and there may be, you see here is the flickr.com, here is the Pixabay, this image from Pixabay, so that becomes as a, see all those it is showing you those resources from where you can take it. All these are open kind of licenses which you can use them free, means without any copyright hindrance for that. Okay, so these were certain sites which we were using for that. Now I want to cover now the next is the videos for our, because to teach, and particularly now even you might have received the letter from UGC, and if you are using SWAMP platform, or if you have to create certain courses as your own online courses or your SWAMP MOOC courses, then video is one of the important quadrants of that. But you cannot just use any video which is available on the internet, because normally what we do, say for example here, I make a search on photosynthesis and I want to search the videos for that. It is showing me all the videos as such there, and they may or may not be copyright protected from there. Say for example, let us just as an example click on this video. And once it comes there, you go to its description, and there it will show you the license which is available. Here it says Creative Commons Attribution License. So this one you can use it. But if there is anything, say for example, this is another image, and if we see its description, what kind of license it shows to us here, reuse allows. So the good way to use them is when you make a search on your topic, say like you go to YouTube. And search for photosynthesis. You click on photosynthesis. It will show you all the results which are there. And now you can see that if you select a video, what kind of license it shows. And there is no license here. It means then now this comes with a standard YouTube license. Now we need to be careful. So what is the way how to find them now? You go to YouTube, you make your search here, and when you the results are displayed, you will see this filter button, it comes up. This filter button allows you to make searches according to these options. So you can upload, you can check when it was uploaded, you can check what type of that, short duration, long duration, and here it is Creative Commons. So you click on this Creative Commons, and now all these videos which you see here, they are all with Creative Commons licenses. You can very well click on anyone, Waterpedia, Strange Animals, you click on that, and then if you go to its description, in the bottom, you will find reuse allowed, Creative Commons license is there. So please be sure that if you are using any video product from here, whether it is allowing you as the Creative Commons or not. If there is no mention of Creative Commons, it means it is standard YouTube license, which is a copyright a thing for that. Now, the another resource which is good for you is the TeacherTube. Did someone know among you about TeacherTube? This you can see, it is a video sharing platform on which you can find the resources, science, mathematics, history, social studies, language arts, and there are so many things. You can browse them. You can see here multiplication. And it has a very big resource. Now this it is for the fourth grade. You can see, you can play, you can download it, and it shows you all those things from here. There is one more resource. It is called as MIT Blossoms Videos. I like this website because it has one unique feature which is not available on various other resources. But this is basically for science and mathematics. So, means those of you who belong to these faculties, they may find it quite useful. And you can see, if you go there, that this is open source science and mathematics repository. And you can find it in various languages. Portuguese is there, Japanese is there, Chinese is there, English is there, Malaysian is there. This is the flag of Malaysia and like that. So there are many resources, and you can click on any resource. Say, for example, you want to see what is correlation. And this is the instructor, Camelia. Here is the video. And the interesting thing here is that it allows you to download the video. Here in this case, it is MP4, which is a universal format. And this is that thing which I like it very much. It allows us to download the transcript. And it is offering you the transcript in both PDF format as well as MS Word format. Now, what is the benefit of having a transcript? The advantage is for those of special needs children, which are, you know, some have a challenge of hearing or something, or understanding the language of the speaker. In that case, you can give them the transcript and then they can read through that and can get the idea from there. So that way it can go with them. So these are certain resources which are for the where you can find certain videos. After that, I will come to sound, because suppose if you are recording your video or if you have prepared your presentation, sometimes for presenting you may like some background music for that. And music is a very comes with a certain protection laws, that any music, unless it is authorized by the music composer, music owner, you won't be able to use that. So there are certain sites for that. One is SoundCloud. You can go to this website, SoundCloud, and it allows you to use their music, to download them and use it for free. Explore, you can, it is available on all the platforms. And you can save, follow, and all for free. You can create your own account also to upload your own music if you want to share it with others. So this is one website. There is another one. It is called as Jamendo. So here you can see that this is free music download and streaming. And you can search from here. So you can search for various genre which is available, and accordingly, if you like anything, you can play by clicking it, and this will start playing. And at the bottom of the page, you can see it is playing. You may not be receiving the audio, or maybe, yeah, I can audio connection. You can share, but then if you think that, then it can be downloaded by clicking on this button. That way, from there you can download it. Then just one more site, Free Sound. क्या हुआ? Okay. So here you can see that this is a collaborative database of Creative Commons licensed sounds. So here you can search their database sounds, and you can see here, and today it is 4th May. This is one of the latest uploaded today, uploaded yesterday, already being downloaded, and some people, they give their feedback. So the star marks are there, and like that you can browse them on the basis of that, then you can use these resources that way. So this is related to sounds. Now, after covering the image, sound, video, let's come to the text, from where we can use the text materials which is available with us. Let me see. Okay, I can close this tab. Free sound.
About situation of high inflation in our country. All right. Which of the three budgets can you talk about?
Okay. So, for text, there are certain open sources. Some of them are Athabasca University Press, and this I like this website because some of the books on this website, they have been translated into many other languages. Just since nowadays the online education is a very hot topic, let me show you some books on that. You just, and there are books available on almost various subjects. So here you can see online distance education, emerging technologies in distance education, is there flexible theory. Let me show you this book on theory and practice of online learning. All these books, they are available to you for free download. And this book has been so popular that it has been translated into around, I think, more than 60 languages. This is free for download and it is an award winning book. You can download. If you want a printed book, this is, say, this work is under Creative Commons, non-commercial purposes. So only you cannot sell it, but you can download the PDF, you can print it and freely distribute it to your students. That is perfectly all right. And here you can see the other, like on mobile learning, learning in virtual world, something. So you can select it, say, like by browser, by subjects. You can see that there are, it offers you books on almost all these subjects which are available for you. And these are the textbooks also. So you can just use them as such, or some portion of that, depending on that which is available with it. There is another source which we call them the Merlot resources. Here you can see. You can browse their catalog, their materials. And it has, you can either, search them with some keyword. You can add your own material into it. And you can find these are for, say, DNA, authentic toolbox, simulation, neuroscience. And in the left, you can see here you can find that you can have filter, say, for example, arts, business, education, humanities, mathematics, science, social science, and then the material type. The figures within the bracket shows you, parentheses indicates the number of those resources, but you can find online courses, presentation, quiz, simulation, tutorials. And then you can see from here audience, which level of education you want to search them. These are available on all these, and there are so many other platforms. It is a very big resource which is available to you. From here, all these product, this content, you can use them freely for your own research work, for your own coursework, or any other need which you have. Then another repository is OpenStax. OpenStax. You can read it here, it is peer reviewed. So here you can see from the subjects, what subjects does it offer to you? Mathematics, science, social science, humanities, it offers you. You can search OpenStax partners, and say for example, if you want to go for humanities, what happened? Okay, here you can see these are peer reviewed, openly licensed, 100% free. And then say for example, here is on history, you can click on that. And here it is showing you table of contents, view online, download a PDF, and then it is showing you suggestion. And here you can see this is licensed at CC BY. It means that even a commercial use of this book is allowed by them. So that way it has the and similarly you can search it for various these other subjects, whatever is you need to search for it. Then there is one other one, it is called as Open Textbook Project of Hong Kong. And here you can see it has the books for primary, secondary, certificate diploma level, or even for tertiary level you can search the books. You click on anything and see here these are the subjects which are available to you. You want to search for social science, arts, humanities, business, information technology, whatever you want to search. For example, here you can see it is the communication theory. This book is CC BY SA, and here read it. It is one of the free open textbook for tertiary level. You are free to use, free to adapt, free to modify the content to your own needs. So it means if you go and you can read, download either the PDF, or you can read this book even online, which can work on your mobile device as well. And when you want to download this book as a PDF and you think that out of the 10 chapters, you need 2 chapters, but with modifications, those you can do them from here. So that way it allows you. You can see here, this is the book and these are the chapters. You can download them. And here is the free documentation license. Network theory, communication, these things, they are already, it has been read by around 2500 times, and that gives you the information about it. So this website says that free to use, free to change, free to share, and so it's a very big repository which you can search. And I'll show you one more, because these are the people who started this movement actually somewhere around 2001. This is called as the MIT. MIT OpenCourseWare. They were the people actually who began with this movement. And you can say find resources. And from there you can make it either department wise or topic wise and browse them. You can see here it represents, and this website offers you full program set complete with everything. We will see some example. You can see School of Architecture is there, engineering is there, science is there, arts, social science, you have history, you have literature, you have political science, you have women's studies, you have science, technology, economics, you have biology, chemistry, earth, physics, something. Say, for example, you want to search something for chemistry. Here is the chemistry department, and you can see the courses, and it tells you what level that. Say, for example, you want to search for organic chemistry. Okay, here is the organic chemistry course. You can view that course. And here is that course, the author. And on the left pane, you can see there is syllabus, there are readings, there are assignments, lecture handouts, download the course materials, everything is there. And here, all things available to you under Creative Commons license. You open any material, there also they will tell you that how you can make use of these resources. So these are those resources. In addition to that, we have, there are certain other examples also, which I would like to show to you. Say, for example, if we see it in Indian context, you all perhaps may be knowing about it. You have, say, Shodh Ganga. So this is the repository on which you can find e-thesis, which our Indian research scholars, they have to upload them, and you can browse here that these are the top universities, which are means which most of them, there so many resources they have. And from here you can see that around how much it is, 269,000 full text theses are available. There are the synopses. But anything which is available here doesn't mean that with closed eyes we will be, you know, making use of them. They allow you with those things that cite them properly if you are using them. But it tells you a good resource that how, you know, you can have for your review of related literature or those things. There you can find these materials. So this is one resource. Then you may be knowing about National Digital Library also. So this is here. It is a repository from multiple subjects like humanities, more than 100 type of learning resources. Here you can find books, more than 64 lakh books by 15 lakh authors. There are question paper, web courses, annual report, solution data set, technical report. There are so many things available, and then you know, you need to create your login and then you can use that. There are so many items, they are hosted in this National Digital Library from there, which you can access. But do read the, when you open any particular object, just check that the, what kind of authorization they allow you to use it. Next, we have another InfliPNet resource. It's a library network. And here you can go with its library, the publication. You can find newsletters. You can check its library, its resources. And the here you can check the reference services, delivery services again. Means on the basis of that, and then CD-ROM based search through the inter-university, inter-library facility, etc. They can have, you know, all those resources which are available for our universities in use. There is an interesting website. This is, just let me type that here. This is the open access theses and dissertations. This is a big resource for you to search the thesis, full thesis, the dissertations, or some other work which has been released as open access. So either you can type your keyword here, or then make a search on that, and then it is showing you that you can use Google Scholar also, or this National Digital Library resources, or Procast thesis and dissertations also, which is another of the database which you can check from there. Okay, from there. And let me, because I may not have time, but I'm pasting some resources in the chat box, which you can save it later on. You can click on these links, you can save these chat messages, and in your free time you can check these resources which are good for you, which you can search, use them to search material for your research or for your work. Now there are few more, then I will invite you question and answers. The digital library, this Gutenberg project has been very famous. To allow you free ebooks, which you can check, you can browse the categories, you can browse their catalogs, you can or make a book search, and from there it allows you to search how you can make use of that. And here you say that mostly they are not protected by copyright law, so our books are freely used in US, and that way it is allowing you, but they are under those kind of license where it offers us to search their material. Another one is this Digital Public Library of America, where it offers you these many image, textbooks, videos, and sounds from across. You can browse and download free ebooks. You can see the open there, the primary source, and here for education, their guide is there. So you can search these resources, browse by partner, browse by topic, and here it shows you the various topics which are available in this resource. Okay, then we have another library from UK, the British Library for research, inspiration, and enjoyment, and you can access their huge resource, and you can see their collection, their catalog. You have thesis from here, you have web archives, you can find digital manuscripts, sounds, etc., etc. A big resource is available to you. Okay, another one, if you remember in my presentation I showed you the Public Library of Science. This is an open access non-for-profit. There is something good about this website is that I think around more than 60 Nobel laureates, they have also contributed their material to this Public Library of Science. Open access, open science as critical in the time. Here it publishes their paper, and you can see it publishes open access journal across all areas of science and medicine. You encourage the scope of each journal, and these are those journals where you can find material for your research. So it has also a big for open science research community. You can publish, you can find, there are the resources for reviewers, for attentions, and you can read more about what this library is. It's a non-profit open access publisher and like that. So here there are 30 from 180, they have signed that they release their material as open access on this website using that. So this is called as Public Library of Science, PLOS. Then we have another resource, which is CLIR Publications. And there also you can browse them. They are full available here. full text of MOOCs are available to download for free on this website. So you can check their reports, their other resources, their issues, annual reports, which may be good for you for your teaching work, for your research work. Okay, let me close some of them. And then you may like to see this Homeland Security of US Digital Library, where they have this thesis and dissertation repository for various universities, University of Texas, open summary, like that. So there you can make a search. This is Homeland Security Digital Library, which they have allowed open full access to their course materials. Then another one is, it is a known patent literature repository by Gray, and here you can say jump over various regions. You want to find something from Asia or from there, and then you can see these are the resources. Japan is there, Hong Kong, Korea, Malaysia is there, and then there are African dissertations. There are the resources. You can find white papers. You can search for webinars, the reports, say patent vital, this is that, exploring. Means it depends. You need to decide that on what area you are working and how that. In addition to that, very recently, Smithsonian Institute, they have also released their content as open access. Here you can see, welcome to Smithsonian Open Access, where you can download, share, reuse millions of Smithsonian's image right now without asking. So you don't need to seek their permission. With new, what they offer you around 3 million 2D or 3D digital images from their collection, like that. So it has a very big resource. Means you can see usage or free if you want, then these are their platforms. For those of you, depending on what kind of work you want to use there, and then it shows you the resources. It has certain very interesting images which are not available elsewhere otherwise out there. So these are some of the sources where you can search material for your teaching, education, or research. So I'm stopping my screen now, and if there are any questions, is TeacherTube, there is a question by Anupma. TeacherTube an open resource? Yes, it is an open resource, but it is not open source. There is a difference between an open access material and open source material. Open source basically goes with, there are two things, open source software as well as open source hardware also. Nowadays there are certain, like if you Google for Raspberry Pi, it is open source hardware. So some of the companies also, they have started releasing their hardware as open source hardware. The difference is that there the code is available and you can edit it, you can modify that. Open access means you have the free access to that. Who creates ebook? Anybody can create ebook. There is a software, it is called as Sigil. Okay, let me share my screen back and maybe I can show it to you. Means who creates ebooks is this question, that anybody can create ebook, even you can create ebook, no issue into that. But the question is, if you want to learn how to create an ebook. So I will suggest that you use this okay. You can see it is free open source ebook creation platform, and you can download it, then you can use it. You know, all these things, they are, it is showing you on its web page. So if you want to create certain books for your own course, this will be a good area for you. Okay, let me go back to my questions. Madhuriji is saying, do we get recording of this lecture? Yes, this session is being recorded. Yeah, if you perhaps on your screen, you may be seeing some red dot blinking, maybe in the upper left corner, that shows that the recording is on. Divyansh is asking, resources in the field of commerce management and law. Yeah, I showed you, please search for Merlot, Merlot, open textbook Hong Kong. In fact, I showed you the home open textbook of Hong Kong. There it has a lot of things in commerce, and open textbook of Hong Kong. All this, what is the difference between plagiarism and similar index? Good question. Let me just open this. Here you can see, and you can say for example, you want to search something for commerce, you make a search on it, and it will return you the things from there. So you need to just search what you want to search. Now Anupama is asking, what is the difference between plagiarism and similarity index? The difference is that plagiarism is an act. It is an act, means if I am shamelessly stealing the content of someone else and I am not citing it, I am not attributing it, that is an act. It is called as plagiarism. Similarity index is the report. It is the a kind of comparison of my work with the standard work and telling that how much both works they are common. And we need to educate, we need to teach our software to tell that what needs to be excluded. The simple reason is the software, if you don't tell it, if you just reuse it in its default form, it may check even is, am, are, those kind of common words which everybody uses, your references. So that's why it is a good idea that if you are making some plagiarism check with a document, please remove the references, because the reference will remain the same. If you are citing my research, and if it is in a APA or MLA or Chicago style, whoever uses it, it will be the same. But the software will go by word by word. It will check it and then it will say, oh, your work is 80% similarity index. So you need to tell the software. And when you upload your document, in that case, then you need to tell the software. At times it takes the names also, but in that case, after the machine reads it, we have to use our human intelligence and ignore that what should be there, what we need to consider, and base our difference on that. Okay, next question is, what is the acceptable level? When I was teaching in Malaysia, in my university, we had the acceptance level of around 22 to 25% acceptance level. Above that, it becomes serious. More than 50% straight away reject. Okay, Madhuriji is saying, my online lecture becomes very monotonous. How can I include image video while giving online lecture, or how can I use chalk and board kind of things? What I do, let me do that. When I teach my students online, let us do one thing here for every one of us. How many are we now? Let me see. There are 82 of us. Wonderful. Okay. Maybe someone of you know about it. Please click on this link which I have posted on the chat box. And you can use your mobile phone, you can use your mobile computer for that. And let me also. Okay, let me also paste it here. So when this screen will come, you will see this screen, which is visible on my page. On the bottom right corner, you will find a pink round button with the plus sign into it. Please click on it, and it will ask you, it will open a box on your page. Let me see here. I need to shift, and I click on it, and then it will show me a box in which I can type, "Hello, I am and then you can upload something with the upload button. You can make something hyperlink, and this is good. You can take a snap. Maybe my camera is being used by this okay, so I think it will not allow me because my camera isn't being used, but and that I can simply say, so just try and introduce yourself. I'll use my mobile phone.
Yeah, excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Hello. Yes. I am Rashmi, sir.
Jay.
I just like to ask which software is interesting for undergraduate teaching learning process?
Oh, no, that
to give a lecture to undergraduate student.
It depends on what is the purpose of
first to give a lecture with lots of diagrams and figures, because I teach environmental studies, so I need to draw so many diagrams, pictures, to show pictures.
Okay, now you will be able to see here me. And perhaps it will come. So you all can upload. Okay, it is uploading on my phone. And very soon it will come here. Yes. So that way you can ask all your participants, if it is an online class, that introduce yourself. Something here. Okay, you want to know. So there is one website which I personally. Okay, friends, please go ahead. You are around more than 80, and I don't, I am only alone here. Okay, I use, say, Canva. This is, you can design anything, you can create anything. And it has a lot of templates into it, and it allows you to create many, many things which you can create. It has a big repository, big template for all kind of image diagrams for your work, including your flowchart, something else, and there. And this is free. Is it okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Sangeeta ji is saying sometimes published papers are included in e-book without permission. That is why I'm asking. Get to know when search something online. Okay. Madhuri ji's screen coming up. Madhuri ji, are you writing something? Because we can see your screen. But I think there is few more things which you can use. Let me take back the control. For you teachers, there is a good resource for you. Okay, where is it? Is share. There are these two websites, Create Your Mind Maps. One is, this is online. And this is to download offline CMAP. You can try this. This is online mind mapping, and you start with them and then keep on creating your mind map. Say for example, this is here, and another example for management, and you can how to create, so you know, and this works very well even on your mobile phone. You have an idea, and from there you show how it is used by to explain any concept for that. Here you can create it online, and this one is, you can download it on your computer and then work offline and then share it as an image or as a PDF with your students. This is a good thing, that when you want to share some content with your students,
if you can create a flow chart.
Yes, yes, anything is possible here. This is used by many people. Okay. Any questions? Okay.
Excuse me, sir. For CMAP, we can draw the flowchart.
Please say again. Okay, Paul Hanish, can you explain CCDY and CX again, and what are the good resources for economics? Thank you. Yeah, that's a good use of a whiteboard to write something. In fact, if you have that writing pen, then your writing can become better. If we use it our finger, then it may be a little bit. Okay, what is meant by CC, BY, NC, SA, etc.? BY is uniform. It says that attribute means acknowledge. In all our resources, the citation has to be there. Unless in those cases in which I show you on the Pixabay or other websites where they say that attribution is not required, there you can leave it. But otherwise, attribution is a must for other things. Wherever it is, if it is CC0 or public domain materials, there you can't, because there is no authorship of anyone. Rest for rest, all, including Creative Commons licenses, including copyright things, the attribution will come. So BY means kiska hai wo, by whom, who is the owner of that. NC stands for non-commercial. So any of the item which is released under non-commercial thing, you cannot make a commercial use of that, means like selling it for profit or something like that. That is not allowed. SA stands for share alike. It means you create a content using some other content, and then you need to give a license to that. If it is SA, the license you cannot change. You will keep the license same. You can make other things out of that. It's okay. So that way. And resources for economics, I have shown you so many websites, and in the chat box I have typed so many links. Just go there of any time, anywhere, and then you, if you type your economic word. In fact, there is very interesting thing. Let me demonstrate it to you. that what Google can do for you. I'll go to simple Google now. I will show you two examples. I remember once, although I gave that presentation, but I'm creating this situation that I attended the presentation of someone, and the presenter was explaining something about our examination system. And he was telling that our examination system is not good one, because in our exam, we have all kind of students in our class, intelligent, average, and below intelligent level. But we give them the same question paper having 5 questions. All questions carry equal mark, and please attempt them. So that was, and he was demonstrating this concept using a photo, in which I remember that there was a tree, there were some animals, and a teacher was conducting an examination. But I forgot the URL of that image, that where I can search that image. So what I will do, I will ask Google. So I will ask examination. There was a tree. There were animals. Let us see if it can show me that photo. See, I just typed 3 words and it is bringing me this image. Let me just little bit enhance it. And here you can see in the right, it says that for a fair selection, everybody has to take the same exam. Please climb that tree. So this way, you know, I'm able to search if I know my exact keywords. Let me show you another example. Once I saw a very good image, which was explaining the power of internet. And it was showing that there was a fire hydrant, and normally fire hydrant in the, like in Europe, they are yellow in color. In India, like we have that postal box in red color, something. So there was this fire hydrant. It was yellow in color, and it was explaining about internet. And I will just type these words and press enter. And let's see what it will show to us. Okay, see here the first image. You can see it is saying that getting information off the internet is like taking a drink from fire hydrant. That way, you know, you need to know that what to search. So the answer to your question, Anish Paulji, is that you can make a Google search. You can use the advanced Google search here by going to the settings and using advanced. And here you can, here it is find images, because I was in image search, but you need to go back to the main Google search. And there you can type, say, advanced Google search. Here you will come on this page, and now you can type what was there, economics, and you can then tell what you want to search. One thing will come here, which language you want to search, and what format, PDF, PPT, what books, and the license, even commercially, share, free, and then click on advanced, and then it will show you. So that way, not only this one, it will allow you to search for any subject on that. If you make a PDF, so it will show you the PDF, resources, which you can check with them like that. So it will show you. Okay. Those of you who are interested in creating, I have shown you these websites for creating e-content, but there, in addition to that, okay, I'm alone here on this page, I'll close it. There are a free website, you can go to it, and you can download its app for your Android phone, for your iOS, and you can create podcast very easily. It's super simple. And if you use this Anchor, then you can upload those your podcasts. Let me close this on your Google Podcasts, this website. This website, it is a free hosting site. So you can create your podcast by using Anchor, and then you can use. Oh, and now I remember one more thing. I could not recall. You asked me about those charts and other things. This is a very good source for you. About you can use Google Charts. For every one of you, if you want to deal with the you know, these things, you can see its gallery. And here you see in the left, just pay attention, the thing which is allows you to create annotation charts, area charts, bar chart, bubble chart, calendar chart, candlestick, column, combo, diff, donut, net, gauge, geo chart, histogram, interval, line, map, pie chart, shankey, scatter, table, timeline, treadless, waterfall charts, etc. And you see these are interactive in nature. It gives you the code also. You can use this, say for example, for this code, and if you put it in your website, you will get it in this way there. So you can use this website also to create your charts online. So what you can do, you can just put your data in here, it will create the resource, and then you can just simply take a selection, take a snapshot and use that also. I was telling you about this website. There is another website, it is called as Hubhopper, for you to create your podcasts. Podcasts are simple audio messages. And then this is Podbeans, another free website. And say like you can click on it.
Mera naam hai Eklavya.
Bada pyara naam hai Eklavya aapko. Achha bataiye aapko pata hai Eklavya kaun tha?
पता है.
अच्छा बताइए कौन था?
जो पुराने जमाने में प्रिंस होता था.
अच्छा जी.
और मेरे
यू कैन विजिट दिस वेबसाइट, बट दीज आर द यू नो वेबसाइट्स वेयर यू कैन क्रिएट. द एडवांटेज ऑफ पॉडकास्ट इज दैट इन दिस कोरोना सिचुएशन मेनी ऑफ आवर स्टूडेंट्स दे आर you know, held up in all kind of places. We are fortunate, we are in Delhi, we have a good internet connection here. But think of those who are in the villages and they cannot, at that time, they cannot see our video. In that case, you can create this small audio messages, and then that can be, you know, WhatsApp or some, because video takes more bandwidth, and you can cover your courses by using these free websites. Okay, let me go back to the chat if there are more questions. Okay, where is the chat? Okay, here. So if there are no questions, then I may request Dr. Nandini or Dr. Priyamji to take over.
Sir.
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, it's been an absolute honor. It's been an absolute honor listening to you. You have made fairly complex things so easy for us to understand. And since all of us are now dealing with online teaching, and we have been doing it for some time now, your inputs are going to be extremely handy. Plus, for those of us who continue to do research, and for younger colleagues who are planning to do research or are doing good research, I think you've covered an entire, you know, a very exciting gamut. And we have learned so much. And from the chat, you can see, sir, all my colleagues are extremely grateful to you. People are also asking if we can remain connected with you, if it is possible for you to take queries. I will not force you, sir, but if it is possible, we would love for you to remain connected with the Bharati family.
I have typed my email ID and my phone number.
It's over. Maybe we will like to have you in person. Yes, sir. We'll be very grateful if you share it.
So I have typed my.
And it's been an extremely illuminating talk, and I think.
No, you are most welcome. Everybody is most welcome. I'll be happy that you can go ahead with your course, and if there is anything where I can be of any assistance.